So welcome to another video here on the Moonlight Sonata. Yesterday we had a video on basically sharing the moderator system of these Viennese pianofortes, which make this instrument really unique, and it's so nice to have, and it adds so much to the color and sound of certain pieces like the Moonlight Sonata. And a second part of that video or that recording session went rather technical, in depth, talking about the notation of that adagio, which seems to be easy, but there is a lot that we can share about that. Common time, cut time, the relationship between those, relationship between the notation and the tempo, and certainly the last word hasn't been said about that, because these adagios and andantes, they mix a little bit, so they have overlap. For instance, this adagio is a little bit faster than some other andantes. So how does that come? The last word, as I said, hasn't been said about that. And we will definitely come back to that subject a lot of more times. So, but if you are interested in some technical notation stuff, then you have clicked on the right video. And I will not make this introduction any longer than necessary. So here you have it. When we dive into the music and in the notation, so let's be a little bit technical here for a few minutes, we see that Beethoven used the signature, the time signature of the alla breve, so the cut time. Now we've made a video on cut time versus common time, and it's not always, well, people often say, well, cut time is twice as fast as common time, which is actually true, but you have to compare the different notations, and that's what we're going to talk about here. This is one of the pieces that, as easy as it seems, still is quite hard to reconstruct from a point of view of notation. So cut time here is called also by Czerny alla breve, but that was done, there was a common practice that sought to call every cut time alla breve, even though the reference to the true and pure alla breve, as I've mentioned in that other video, is not always there. So briefly, you have common time here and you have cut time here. The tempo is indeed 1-2. So when you add cut time, you could say, well, tempo is twice as fast as common time. So if you have, for a normal tempo ordinario, common time 60 for the quarter note, you go to 60 half note in single beat, so in our modern metronome reading. But there is one big condition that's often forgotten and which is really important. You have to see the notation. When you go from common time, the normal notation there is to have, let's say, 2 harmonic changes per bar and the fastest structural note value, 16th note. Now, this is all technical, but if you open the score from a normal sonata, Haydn or Mozart, even Beethoven, you can easily see that for yourself. Oftentimes, not always, but you will find many of these normal notations in the first movements of sonatas. So then, common cut time, the really alla breve, is double in tempo, but you'll use the half of the note value. So instead of using 16th notes for the fastest note value, you use 8th notes only. And instead of using 2 harmonies per bar, in general, you use only 1. So in real tempo, I mean speed of the note values, the 8th notes in alla breve go as fast as the 16th notes in a normal common time. The reason why they changed that is because of the articulation and the characters. So here we have clearly something in between. You could say, well, the piece is developing by whole bars in harmony, unless some bars, and that's a little bit problematic here at the end. There you clearly have 2, if not more, harmonies, but yeah, it takes you outside this really alla breve form, but you have also the use of the triplets. So triplets is what in common time would be the use of 16 triplets, and it's written all over the place. I mean, Czerny writes about that. It's actually, you read that in Leopold Mozart and C.P.E. Bach and Gottlob Türk. If note values become faster in the notation or harmonic changes become more dense, you reduce the tempo. So if you combine this with going to look in more and other scores in the 19th century, you often hear the critique on those scores, like in Moscheles doesn't have the cut time, Bülow doesn't have cut time. They just use the normal C from Common Time. But if you compare, if you notice that Common Time is here, Alla Breve is there, but that we are here now in Alla Breve tempo, that's somewhat below. But the opposite is true as well, that if you start from Common Time and you're not using 16th notes as fastest note value, but only 8th note triplets, your tempo goes up as well. So there's somewhere in the middle where they meet. And that's this notation. Even though it's so open, it's so inviting to, well, say this is a normal Alla Breve, it is not. Having said that, the reconstruction of this tempo is not really easy. So the metronome numbers, and I say that because this is an adagio sostenuto, which in a way, regardless of any tempo that you choose for this piece, is conflicting a little bit with the use of the Alla Breve sign. So what Beethoven does is he says, well, I'm using this cut time to make sure the piece is not too slow. But on the other hand, I'm using a notation that slows down from the normal cut time. And this sounds really complex, but that's how they worked. And if you understand that basic principle of fastest note value and harmonic changes, then you see it everywhere. It's not so hard to see. But as a composer, you have something in mind. And how are you going to note that music down? We could try to reconstruct this piece. It might be for another video. See what other possibilities Beethoven had for reaching the same tempo. Oftentimes, you see that composers in that time were oftentimes spot on what they wanted. And if you go to reflect on that, what alternatives were there? And it's a really interesting exercise to do. You'll find that you'll come to the same notations as they did. So another thing to really step down from this Alla Breve, so the classical, old, pure sense Alla Breve, is also the use of the 16th notes in the melody. So here I have the triplets, and then you have the 16th note. That will never happen in an old Alla Breve, never ever. See the Hammerklavier Sonata first movement, that doesn't happen. So they were very aware of this very subtle system that they applied over and over again. So what happened in that time, and it's a little bit off topic, is that you got all these movements, these different shades of tempo. If you compare that with the mensural notation, the Renaissance music, where you have basically one tempo and the note values were in proportion to that one tempo, well, then life is easy. But that's changed, and so they opened the box of Pandora, so to say, where you had, adagio, andante, allegro, you had presto and prestissimo, basically around 1800, and allegretto and things in between. Then they started to add andante con moto, allegro assai, adagio quasi of andante quasi allegretto. So they tried to come to many, many different tempo shades, because tempo indicates and actually forms the character of the piece. And that's the reason why this call for a tempo measure or takt measure at the end of the 18th century became so big. But that's, again, that's for another topic. So, and it's an interesting topic. Here we have a metronome number by Czerny, 60 of the quarter note. In the Simrock edition, he gives 54 in the pianoforte school, and that's actually a span of all metronome numbers you will find in the 19th century. So Moscheles gives 60 all the time, Bülow gives 52, which is even a little bit slower than Czerny's in pianoforte school, but that is actually it. So 60 it is, or 58, it's not so much difference. So if you play this in whole beat, then you will have to reconstruct the tactus inequalis. So you could also recalculate this tempo into half beat, which it certainly was done, but it's not necessary. So we start from listening to the tempo now. So 60 is the second. Chuck, chuck, chuck. And when you feel that, chuck, and two, and. And then there's a little bit of practice. I need to practice that as well, is to go from this binary, so this equal tactus equalis, so equal time, tac, tac, to unequal. And what you do then is you kind of remember the downbeat, yak, rak, and tac. And then you go unequal, tac, and tac, and tac. And then if you listen in your mind, you can already hear the triplets, chang. So going from tactus equalis, which is by definition a pendulum over metronome, is tactus, they cannot go irregular. So to inequalis needs a little bit of practice, but it's the old practice and still conductors do that. What's great about this is that you have the natural feeling for accentuation. And you get this tempo. Oftentimes these adagios, but also the andantes, they work great if you learn to feel the half seconds. So the metronome that would be in the 30 range. So you will see many adagios are in that range or in the 80 range. You know, then you have 40. That's a little bit faster. Once you start feeling that half second a little bit faster and going up to 60, that's the range actually from adagio to a rather faster andante. Andante, adagio, you have overlaps there. You have adagios who are faster than the slower andantes. And you have to see the notation. If you have an adagio, for instance, this video is getting way too long, but it's actually interesting to share that with you. So for instance, the C major adagio of the opus 2 number 3, we just recently did that in a practicing session. That's one of the slower adagios. So here you have it. So 56 is the average tempo here. We are for the eighth note, so we are double as slow as the adagio sostenuto of the Mondstein. So you have, that's the tempo here. It's a very complex piece regarding notation. Then for instance, the adagio of the first sonata, let me give you that as well. It's over here. Yes. Also with a lot of 30 second runs, but harmonically a little bit more open. So what do you see there? The average tempo is 80. So that's a little bit faster. Something in the range of this. But then you have, but you have also andantes in that tempo. Like for instance here, that's the andante from the opus 28. That's sonata number 15 in D major. That's 84, 92. Moscheles gives 100. So let's take 92. Sorry. So if you just count the ticks here, then this andante is slower than this adagio, because here the ticks go in 92. Well, yeah, if I use 92, it's actually the same, because I can just directly use this tempo. So the eighth notes here go as fast or as slow as the 16th notes in an andante. So it all depends on the notation. And that's really important to remember. You cannot say, I'm not hearing an adagio, I'm not hearing an andante. It depends on the notation and combined with that, the character of the piece. If for instance, the first sonata and then the one, this Andante that I just played, and the of the D major sonata, they have the same tempo, but the Adagio makes the F major sonata of the F minor sonata, the F major Adagio, much more serious, or much more, my series maybe not essentially, but in performing you will see that you hold back a little bit more than in the Andante where you have the distributed tempo, like someone walking. So it is all nuanced, and I'm not saying that I know every detail about it, because it's something that takes time to get an overview for. So this Adagio, yeah, in tempo it is rather fast, I think, even in Holby. So yeah, there you have it. It was a way more technical video than I planned actually, but that's how it goes. We cannot escape if you want to reconstruct things of the past, that you dive into things a little bit deeper and talk about notation and talk about tempo ordinario and talk about what happens, what is the relationship between tempo ordinario, common time, and alla breve, and how actually is it used by these composers, because that's actually a foundational question that comes first for the metronome numbers. The metronome numbers are a great tool in helping to understand the nuances and the subtleties that those composers and musicians actually, if you see all the metronome numbers, they are so alike throughout the 19th century that they must have understood very well. And the system on its own, it's not really complex, but what we have lost a little bit is the true understanding of the character that goes behind it. And there the metronome numbers come in play and come at help, because if you follow those in whole beat reconstruction, as I believe, then they will lead you, they will guide you, not only in understanding the movement, more on the notation, but also in reconstructing the character of the piece. It comes with a new way of performance practice all the time. It's not something that you cannot copy-paste from what you're used or from what you know from your daily life as a musician or as a music lover. You cannot copy-paste that. It comes with a new language. It's really speaking, learning to speak a new language based on the same grammar book that we all know so well, the grammar being the composition, the notes. So suddenly those notes speak another language, and that's actually so fascinating to do. So I really hope that in the future, experimenting with our musical heritage becomes more a kind of the norm, certainly back in the historical informed performance practice, because we really lost that a little bit, not to say a lot. And I see a lot of positive signs with the younger generation that have to find their own way. But that's all, that's this movement actually should be only about that, and not about finger pointing. I know how Beethoven played, because we don't. And that's, I will close this video with that. We will never, ever reconstruct the way Beethoven played. It's impossible. It's over. That time has gone. We can only try to come as close as possible. That's actually the name of the channel. Authentic Sound is not, it might indicate, sometimes I see people freaking out with reading that name, but it's not that what I do is the Authentic Sound. Actually, it's reconstructing bits and pieces of that authentic sound using contemporary instruments like the clavichord was the initial idea. But it's only fragments. But sometimes, and that's the great thing, and it's so hard to share and to, you know, it's no proof, it's actually nothing. But sometimes you have the feeling that you see something at, you know, there on the horizon that makes sense. Suddenly you say, oh my God, yes. Oh yeah, yeah, this is a new reality. Makes you happy as a musician, I can promise you that. Hard to share, but those are the essential moments in this journey, because there you have this feeling, yeah, maybe there's something that we reach, our fingertops reached with each other. You'll never know, and that's a fascinating thing. We will never know. So let's experiment and let's rediscover. And I'm great you are here all with me on this journey. So thank you for watching. Thank you also for subscribing if you haven't done so. Certainly hit that bell icon and set your notification system properly, because YouTube is not sending you notifications for these videos. Also not for the live streams and the premieres at the Clavichord, which is a pity, because there is the community of Authentic Sound coming together with actually great chats sometimes to read. And thank you for, I would like to end with a big thank you for my patrons. As always, they make this all happening. That I'm sitting here and spending time making this video is actually partly greatly because of them. So if you haven't heard of our Patreon page, there's a link here and in the description box below. I appreciate you checking that out. And for now, see you soon again.